Tentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Lamb to the Slaughter by William W. Johnstone and J. A. Johnstone. Narrated by Jon Waters. Chapter 1.
I ain't sure how much longer I can make it,
Bart McCoy gasped when Roy Tate reached up to help him out of the saddle.
I'm bleed pretty bad.
You just hang on, Roy told him. We've got to let these horses rest, or we're going to be trying to make it to Tinhorn on foot. I'm going to set you down under the trees. We'll let the horses drink some water and rest a little, and I'll see if I can tighten that bandage up some more.
According to that feller back at the store at the crossroads to Athens, we can't be but an hour's ride from Tinhorn. That was almost 4 hours ago, so don't cash in on me now. We've got plenty of time to get there before supper time. Come on, lean on over this way.
Although wounded, Bart reluctantly did as asked and leaned over to let Roy catch his weight on his shoulders.
I believe we lost that posse, Roy said, as he walked Bart over to settle him against a sweet gum tree while he took care of the horses. I believe they went after Eli and the other boys. When I get back, I'll build a small fire big enough to boil us a cup of coffee. That'll buck you up a little.
I appreciate it, Roy,
Bart forced out painfully.
You could have left me back there at the fork and gone with Eli and the others. I ain't never gonna forget that.
I couldn't have just rode off and left you with a bullet in your side like Eli and them did, Roy declared.
I wouldn't have blamed you if you had gone with him, because there ain't no telling if you'll ever get your share of that money. Eli ain't even gonna count it till they're somewhere safe tonight.
Bart knew it wasn't like Roy Tate to trust anyone with his share of a holdup. He also knew Eli Curry well enough to know he would hardly go to the trouble of finding them to give them their share of that Wells Fargo cash shipment. Eli was a loser all the way around. Instead of his share of the cash, Bart got a bullet in his side. He never was a lucky individual, so he wasn't surprised that of the 6 men, he was the only one the Wells Fargo guard shot before Eli shot down the guard. Bart's only hope for the present was that there might be a doctor in the little town of Tinhorn. He was still in a mild state of shock at Roy Tate volunteering to stay with him to find a doctor before the money was split. It just wasn't like him to let anybody ride off with his share of the money. Almost as if he knew what Bart was thinking, Roy looked at him and smiled.
I wouldn't worry about it if I was you. You'll get your share of the money. We both will. See, when we was getting ready to leave that first place, we stopped to rest the horses. You remember that, right? And Eli was telling you how sorry he was we was gonna have to leave you, 'cause we had to ride fast? Well, when he was telling you that, I noticed nobody was paying attention to those 3 money bags tied behind Eli's saddle. I told myself, them bags look uneven, one hanging on one side and 2 hanging on the other. So I thought it'd be a good idea to even them up a little. That Black Morgan he rides ought to appreciate it, and this way we don't lose our share of the job.
Bart was so shocked by Roy's bold statement he almost forgot his pain for a few moments.
I swear, he blurted. Are you japing me?
Roy shook his head.
You took one of those bags off of Eli's horse?
Roy nodded, grinning all the while.
You know he'll be coming after us,
Bart warned. He don't know where we went, Roy said. He didn't ask me where I was gonna take you, so I didn't even have to tell him a lie. If he had any notion of coming to find us and give us our share of the money, don't you reckon he might have asked me where he was headed?
He's gonna be mad as hell when he stops for the night and finds out one of them bags is missing,
Bart said.
If he don't notice before that, when him and the other boys left us back on the other side of Tyler, and we started out, you cut back and changed direction so many times I thought you were trying to lose the posse. Then I thought you were just trying to see if you could hurry me along so I'd go ahead and bleed out and you wouldn't have to fool with me no more.
Roy laughed. No such a thing, partner. I was more concerned with not leaving a trail for Eli to follow in case he discovered he was missing a bag before we got very far. I know he wanted to do the dividing up hisself, but I don't figure we're cheating him or the other boys. There's 4 of them, and they've got 2 bags. That's 2 shares to a bag. There's 2 of us, and we've got 1 bag. Seems fair to me.
I ain't never cheated a partner in this business. He decided not to explain one of the reasons he didn't want to leave a trail for Eli was because Bart's condition left some question about whether or not he would make it. There was no sense in sharing Bart's share with the others, if he failed to survive his wound. They sure as hell didn't offer any help to take care of him. With Bart settled against a tree, Roy went to take care of the horses, and when he came back, he collected enough dry branches and limbs to build a fire.
You feel like you want to drink a little coffee?
I reckon, Bart answered. A little bit, anyway. I don't think I can eat anything right now.
That's good, because I ain't got anything to eat. We ought to find something to eat in Tinhorn. You ever been there?
Nope.
Bart gasped painfully when he tried to shift his position against the tree.
Well, I hope they've got some place to buy something to eat, since me and you can afford to buy us anything we want,
Roy boasted.
How much you think is in that bag?
Bart asked, his curiosity stronger than his sense of pain at the moment.
I don't know, but Eli said the total shipment was $50,000, and they had it in three separate bags. Them bags look pretty much equal, so what's three into 50,000?
He brushed the leaves away to expose some bare ground to use for a slate.
Too bad we ain't got numbers here. He could do this in his head.
Roy broke off a twig to use for a pencil and scratched his figures out on the ground. He worked for a while trying to remember the little bits his mother had tried to teach him before she gave up.
Hell, I know that 15,000 doubled is 30,000, and another 15 would make 45,000. So that just leaves 5,000 to split up three ways. Like I said, those three bags look pretty much the same to me. So we know we got at least 15,000 in that bag, plus a third of 5,000.
He paused to work those figures in his mind. I expect we've got $16,000 plus a little extra. That'll give us at least 8,000 apiece. Ain't bad for a day's work.
How come nobody saw that bag after you took it off Eli's saddle?
Bart asked, still amazed Roy had gotten away with it.
I dropped it under the creek bank, just in case he did notice it was gone,
Roy said with a chuckle.
Let's go ahead and count it now, Bart said. It's going to drive me crazy till we do.
Roy laughed.
It's working on my mind too, so I'll empty it out here on the ground and we'll see how rich we are.
They carefully counted all the money in the sack. When they came up with a total of $20,000, they figured they must have miscounted, and counted it again. When they reached the same total the second time, they realized that pure luck had given them a sack with $10,000 each.
Them other two sacks was just holding $30,000,
Roy exclaimed.
Damned if we didn't skunk them on the money split, and we didn't even know it.
He threw his head back and issued a real horse laugh.
He's gonna be fit to be tied when he finds out we got 10,000 apiece.
After the horses were rested, Roy got Bart back in the saddle again, feeling wealthier than when they had stopped. They continued on to the town of Tinhorn. Coming in from the north, the most critical question in Bart's mind was answered right away when Roy spotted the sign on the first house they saw. Dr. John Thomas Beard, it read.
Well, danged if that ain't convenient, Roy declared.
Looking up ahead, he could see the town was a little more than he had expected. The next building on the same side as the doctor's was a hotel.
That's convenient, too.
Although he couldn't read nor write, he knew the word hotel, just like he knew saloon and doctor.
This place is bigger than I thought it was.
He turned his horse onto the path that led up to the doc's office and living quarters.
Looks like you got a patient coming in,
doc's wife Bertie informed him.
Two men on horseback. One of them bent over like he's hurt. Want me to go see?
No,
doc answered and put his coffee cup on the table.
I'll go see what they need.
He got up from the kitchen table and walked to the front of the house, which served as his office. He arrived just as Roy was coming through the front door.
You the doctor? Roy asked.
I'm Dr. Beard. What can I do for you?
My partner's got a gunshot wound, and he's bleeding pretty bad,
Roy said.
Can you take a look at it?
Bring him on in here, and we'll see how bad it is. Can he walk? Do you need help carrying him?
No, sir, Roy replied. I can get him in here without no trouble. It was an accident. I was cleaning my gun.
I don't care how he got shot, Doc interrupted. That's between him and whoever shot him. Just bring him in and put him on the table in there.
He pointed to the open door of his examining room.
Where is the wound?
In his side.
Well, take him in there and get his shirt off him, and we'll take a look.
Doc went back to the kitchen to tell his petite Cherokee wife he would need her, while Roy went outside to help Bart get off his horse.
What did you tell him about how I got shot?
Bart grunted painfully as he leaned on Roy for support.
I started to tell him I was cleaning my gun and it accidentally went off, but he didn't let me finish. Said he didn't care how you got shot, so I don't reckon we have to worry about him causing us any trouble.
Roy helped Bart inside the door, then took him to the examining room and helped him get his shirt off. Doc went in, followed by Bertie, carrying a pan of hot water.
This is my wife. She'll be helping me.
To prevent any insult to his wife because she was an Indian, he always introduced her as his wife, especially when working on gunshot wounds and strangers who looked as if gunshot wounds were not unusual in their lives.
Ma'am,
Roy greeted her politely, and Bart nodded his head. After a careful examination, Doc informed Bart the bullet was deep in his side and would continue to cause him pain unless it was removed.
On surgery like this, I usually charge $25 because I'll have to do a lot of cutting and stitching. It won't kill you if I just fix the hole, but it'll aggravate you for the rest of your life.
Go ahead and fix me up, right, Doc?
Bart said without hesitation.
I've got the money to pay you. Don't worry about that.
We'll get started right away.
Doc motioned to Bertie to get the chloroform.
It's going to take a good little while, he told Roy. So you might want to get yourself something to eat or a drink or two. But if you'd rather wait here, you can just make yourself comfortable in the parlor. He won't know whether you're here or not. I'm going to put him to sleep.
Bertie came back then with a clean cotton cloth and a bottle of chloroform.
I noticed a hotel right down the street there, Roy said. I think I'll go see if we can get us a room. I don't think Bart's going to be ready to travel right away. I reckon I'll have plenty of time to take care of the horses, too.
Good idea. He might feel a little sick from the chloroform, Doc told him and watched him go out the door. If he's thinking about staying in the hotel, maybe they do have enough money to pay my bill, he was thinking.
You couldn't tell it by looking at him, he said aloud.
What you say? Bertie asked.
Nothing. I was just talking to myself.
Doc took the bottle of chloroform and the cotton pad from her and returned to his patient. After he got Bart to lie back on the table in a comfortable position, he poured some of the chloroform on the cotton pad and held it under Bart's nose.
Just breathe in real deep, he instructed, and continued the process until Bart passed out.
The surgery was quickly done, and the wound bandaged before Bart showed any signs of waking up. So he was still on the table when Roy returned.
How's he doing, Doc?
Roy asked when he came back in the office to find Doc Beard sitting at his desk.
He'll be ready to go in a few minutes, Doc answered. He's just waking up right now. I'll tell you, since he might still be a little groggy from the chloroform, tell him to leave that bandage on for 3 days before he changes it. Tell him to keep it dry and don't take a bath for 3 days.
Roy chuckled in response.
Won't be no trouble there. He can go 3 months if you want him to.
When can he ride?
To start with, it'd be best not to have him bouncing around on a horse for a couple of days, Doc advised. After that, it's up to him. If it doesn't bother him, he can get on a horse then.
Fine and dandy, Roy said. Appreciate you taking care of him. I'll settle up with you now, and he can pay me later.
How much did you say it was?
Doc had told him it was $25, same as he had quoted him.
25, Roy repeated.
That's a little steep, but I ain't complaining.
I'll tell Bart you charged 50.
He japed.
I rented us a room in the hotel, so I'll see if I can get him over there to rest up.
You feel like eating some supper?
Roy asked, after Bart had rested up a little and seemed to have recovered from his surgery.
Yeah, I think so. I know I'm hungry enough to eat a horse.
Well, let's go on over to the dining room and see if they've got a horse on the menu. Doc Beard told me they serve pretty good cooking. Clara's kitchen is what they call the dining room. We'll see if Clara cooks good enough to satisfy two rich gents like you and me.
They stepped into the hallway. Roy locked the door to their room and led the way down the hall to the inside door to the dining room. Bart walked carefully behind him, When they stepped inside the dining room, they automatically looked the room over before committing to a table. Clara Rakestraw looked up when the door from the hotel opened and the two strangers walked in. She watched to see if they read the sign by the weapons table and was not surprised when they paid it no attention. It was the usual occurrence with customers new to town.
"Good evening, gentlemen," Clara greeted them. "May I ask you to leave your weapons on the table there while you're our guest in the dining room?"
"Good evening to you, little lady," Roy answered her. "You certainly may ask us, but we ain't inclined to take 'em off. We like to keep 'em handy, especially when that big feller sitting at the table by the kitchen door is wearing his."
"He's also wearing a sheriff's badge," Clara politely told them. "Officers of the law are allowed to wear their weapons in the dining room."
She pointed to the sign in the center of the table pertaining to the matter, then gave them a friendly smile.
"Maybe I need to print a bigger sign."
"Ain't no problem," Roy said at once, but he was thinking she could make the sign 10 feet tall if she wanted. He still wouldn't be able to read it.
"We were just so anxious to try the food out that we didn't pay no mind to the sign."
He unbuckled his gun belt at once.
"Come on, Bart, peel that belt off. They ain't gonna feed us if you don't."
When Bart winced suddenly in the process of removing his weapon, Roy asked,
"You need help?"
"No, I got it,"
Bart answered and carefully pulled his gun belt off, then handed it to Roy. Seeing Clara's inquisitive expression, Roy explained.
"He just came from the doctor's office, had to have a little surgery done on his side, and he ain't too frisky right now."
"Well, let's not make him stand here waiting,"
Clara said and ushered them to the closest table.
"Bonnie will be taking care of you. Do you want coffee?"
"Yes, ma'am, we sure do," Roy said.
Clara went at once to the kitchen to tell Bonnie. In less than a minute, Bonnie came to the table with 2 cups of coffee.
"Look here, Bart. They keep getting prettier and prettier," Roy declared. "Don't matter whether the food's fit to eat or not, we'll just admire the scenery."
"You fellas are new in town, ain't you?"
Bonnie asked.
"That's right," Roy answered. "And we could use some company to show us what there is to do here. Maybe you'd like to do that, show us a little of what we've been missing."
"Well, now, I don't know," Bonnie replied. "I reckon I'd have to check with my husband about that."
"Hell, I won't tell him if you don't," Roy chuckled.
"He'd know anyway,"
Bonnie said.
"He's sitting right here. I'll go ask him."
She pointed to Buck Jackson, sitting at the table by the kitchen door, and made a move to leave.
"Whoa, wait a minute," Roy exclaimed. "You're married to the sheriff?"
"Why, yes. You didn't know that? You are new in town."
"I sure am," Roy replied. "And I don't want to get thrown in the jailhouse my first day in town. Why don't we just back up a little bit? You just bring me and my partner some supper, and we won't bother the sheriff."
"Good idea,"
she said.
"What's it gonna be, beef stew or steak and potatoes?"
"I swear I'm hungry enough to eat both of them. Because of Bart's surgery, we missed dinner, didn't we, Bart?"
"I don't know."
After a moment, Roy said,
"I think I'll try the stew. That ought to be quicker, since you just dished that out. You'd have to fry a steak, right?"
Bonnie nodded, so Bart took the same. When she went to the kitchen, Roy commented,
"I'd heard of Tinhorn, but I didn't think they were big enough to hire a sheriff."
"Well, they've got one, and it looks like they wanted a big one,"
Bart said, taking another look at Buck Jackson, sitting by the kitchen door. Chapter 2
"You want some more coffee?"
Mindy Moore asked.
"I think that ought to do me for the night. Fix me up a plate for Ralph. I expect he'll think I forgot him if I don't get back with his supper pretty soon."
"I'll tell Margaret to get it ready,"
Mindy said as she filled his coffee cup.
"Is Flint coming to eat here tonight?"
"Yeah,"
Buck said, grinning broadly, for he knew it was more than a casual conversation.
"He said he was planning to get back in time to get some supper here. That's the reason I've been sitting here so long, but I reckon I'd better take Ralph his supper."
"How long are you going to keep that man in jail?"
Mindy asked.
"I thought he was supposed to go on trial 2 months ago."
Her question caused Buck to chuckle again.
"He's serving a life sentence. Me and Flint put him on trial. He's there for life or until he walks out. His cell ain't locked. As his punishment, he has to keep the jail cleaned up and take care of any other prisoners we have in there. He's doing a pretty good job, so far. I believe he's gonna stay with us for a good while.
Who pays for the food you and Flint take him?
She wondered.
Same deal as always, Buck said. He's still a prisoner, so we still feed him. Same as it was for Roy Hawkins before he got killed. Ralph just took over Roy's job. Well, well, he said, then, seeing his deputy, Flint Moran, walk to the door. Here's Flint now.
He was glad for the opportunity to change the subject. The topic of Ralph Cox was not one he was comfortable trying to explain. He was a former prisoner who had escaped from the jail before, but both Buck and Flint were convinced Ralph had just been unfortunate to have ridden with a real hardened killer. They became convinced he was no real threat to anyone. So they called off his trial and gave him the opportunity to stay in jail as a free man. With nothing legal about his pardon, they were reluctant to talk about it. Seeing Buck still at the table, Flint said,
"Good evening,"
to Clara, and walked on back to join him. As Flint passed the table near the door, Roy Tate looked over at Clara and shrugged. His two hands spread up and out, his face a mask of confusion. She understood his confusion and answered with a gesture of her own. Pointing to her chest, she mouthed the word badge. Roy slowly shook his head and said to Bart,
"I swear, this little town is eat up with lawmen."
They both watched Flint as he pulled out a chair and sat down at the table with the sheriff. The other waitress had already gone to fetch his coffee by the time he was settled.
"I wonder if that other little gal is married to him," Roy mumbled after Bonnie placed their food on the table.
"Maybe we ought to take our meals at the saloon, if they've got a cook," Bart suggested.
"The desk clerk at the hotel said that they had a cook at the saloon, but the cooking was a lot better here," Roy said.
"Well, of course he's gonna say that," Bart replied. "I reckon we'll have to decide that for ourselves. It's kind of cramping my style to be settin' in here eating with the sheriff and his deputy."
"We ain't got nothing to worry about," Roy assured him. "Even if they've heard about that Wells Fargo job, it was a robbery by a gang of 6 men.
What if they've heard that one of that gang got shot and me sitting here with a bullet hole in my side?"
"We'll tell him what I started to tell the doctor, that I shot you when I was cleaning my gun. They ain't gonna arrest us for that. Even if they did, they'd just arrest me for shooting you. So let's just eat this grub and get out of here."
Roy attacked his plate of stew with serious intent. He had consumed a good portion of it when he noticed Bart wasn't eating at all.
"What are you waiting for? Ain't you gonna eat? I thought you wanted to eat a horse."
"I thought I did," Bart answered. "But all of a sudden, I don't feel so good. I think maybe I should have stayed in that bed a little longer before I tried to set up here and eat."
Noticing what looked to be some problem at their table, Clara walked over to see if anything was wrong. When she looked at the two plates, one of them half finished, the other one untouched, she inquired,
"Is something wrong with the food?"
Looking as if in pain, Bart answered,
"No, ma'am, ain't nothing wrong with the food, it's me. The doctor knocked me out with some kind of medicine when he fixed my wound, and I think it must be making me feel kind of sick."
He looked at Roy in distress.
"I gotta go back to the room, give me the key."
When Roy made motions as if about to get up, Bart quickly insisted,
"I don't need no help. You stay here and take your time."
"All right, if you're sure."
Roy handed him the room key. "I'll pay for yours, too. You just go on back to the room." Bart got to his feet and headed back to the hotel. He was in the hallway before he remembered to turn around, go back, and retrieve his gun from the table. The little disturbance at their table did not go unnoticed at the table next to the kitchen door, especially when Bonnie returned to see if there was a problem. When Bart walked out the second time, Flint volunteered to go over to see if they needed any help.
"Is something wrong?"
Flint asked when he arrived at the table.
"Do you need some help, Clara?" "No, this gentleman's friend just had some surgery done, and I think he got sick from the medicine Doc used to put him to sleep."
She looked back at Roy.
"I'll put his plate in a paper bag, and you can take it back with you. Maybe he'll feel more like eating later on."
"That would be mighty kind of you,"
Roy said, his eyes never leaving Flint's face, anxious to read his reactions.
"When did he have the surgery?"
Flint asked.
Roy said he'd had it that morning. Flint said, I reckon he was pushing it a little too soon at that. What kind of surgery did he have?
He had a wound in his side. The doctor had to put him to sleep because he had to go in him pretty far to fix it.
What happened to him? What kind of wound did he have?
I shot him,
Roy answered bluntly. Flint's eyebrows lifted in surprise. Roy smiled and explained.
We was settin' by the campfire last night. I hadn't cleaned my gun in a while, so I decided to clean it. I was loading it back up, and I thought I left an empty cylinder. Bam! The fool thing went off and caught Bart in the side.
He shook his head as if unable to believe he had done it.
I'd never done nothing like that before in my whole life. I thought I had killed my partner.
He chuckled, then added, We're still partners, but he won't let me clean my gun anywhere near him anymore. Flint laughed with him.
Well, I couldn't say as how I blame him. You fellas in town for long, or just passing through?
Just passing through, Roy replied. But we ain't in no particular hurry. I reckon we'll wait till Bart feels more like spending the day in the saddle again. The doctor said he ought to hold off for a day or two before getting back on a horse.
Well, enjoy your stay in Tinhorn,
Flint said, and returned to his table to find a plate of food waiting for him, a napkin placed over it to keep the heat from escaping.
Mindy fixed that up for you so your supper won't get cold, Buck said, unable to resist teasing his young deputy.
When Flint didn't respond, Buck asked,
What was that about? Anything requiring the attention of the law?
Flint told him what had happened that caused one of the men to leave and go back to the hotel.
You say he shot the other fella?
Buck asked.
Yeah, said it was an accident. Said his gun went off when he was cleaning it,
Flint replied.
Nope,
he answered when Buck asked him if he believed it.
He just doesn't look like the type to be careless with a gun.
I reckon we better keep an eye on the two of them, but I don't expect they're up to anything in Tinhorn with one of them shot in the side. Just came here to see the doctor, I figure, and they'll move on.
Buck got to his feet when Mindy came back with a plate for Ralph.
I'd best take Ralph his supper before it gets cold, he said, and walked out the door, nodding briefly to Roy when he went past.
Mindy brought a plate with a couple more biscuits for Flint. Then she cleared Buck's dishes off the table. She came back with a coffee pot and topped off his cup.
You almost waited too late to get any supper,
she said, just to start a conversation.
Yep, I reckon I did cut it a little close,
he admitted.
Claire will be putting up the clothes sign in about 15 minutes, and we'll start cleaning up. This coffee is still pretty fresh, and the pot is over half full. I think I'll pour myself a cup and sit down and enjoy it before I clean up these tables.
She waited, making no move to get a clean cup until, finally, he responded.
You might as well sit down right here and drink your coffee, he invited. That is, if you ain't particular about the company you keep. Why, I'd be honored to sit and have coffee with one of our brave lawmen,
she said, attempting to keep her tone casual. She hurried over to the sideboard to fetch a clean cup moments before Bonnie came to get the coffee pot.
Mind if I borrow a little of that?
Bonnie teased.
Or is this a private party? My customer would like another cup. Take it,
Mindy said.
I think there's about one cup left in it.
She quickly looked back at Flint.
Did you want another cup? Because if you do, I'll make you a fresh pot.
As soon as she said it, she flushed red, knowing how that must have sounded. She cringed when she looked at the grinning face of Bonnie Jones. Oblivious to the teasing Mindy was the target of, Flint said,
No thanks, I've had enough. Reckon I'd best get about to business I was hired for and take a look around town. Thanks for the company, Mindy. It sure beats eating with Buck.
He walked to the register and settled up with Clara, nodded to Roy, who was the only customer left, and went out the door. Flint took a walk up one side of the main street and down the other before he returned to the sheriff's office to see if Buck was going to retire to his private quarters next to the office. The town council was still concerned about Buck's drinking problem, which was the main reason Flint was hired as a deputy. It had become well known that Buck retired every night right after supper to wrestle with his demons till daylight again. The town had no real problems with this arrangement due to Buck's reputation as a sheriff before alcohol sank its talons into the man. As the out-of-the-way little town began to attract more settlers and
consequently more outlaws. However, the part-time law arrangement failed to protect the town. That was when Flint Moran had entered the scene. He'd been Buck's personal pick to act as his deputy, and the town was soon to see the wisdom in his selection. As for Flint, he was ready to leave the family's small farm, already burdened with the welfare of his two older brothers and their families. It promised a slim future if he decided to raise a family there, too. It was a bonus for Flint, Buck, and the town of Tinhorn, as well, when Flint turned out to be one hell of a lawman. Satisfied that the town seemed quiet, as usual, for a weekday night, Flint returned to the jail to find Ralph in the office cleaning up the bench where he had eaten his supper.
"The sheriff's gone to his room," Ralph said. "He said to give him a holler if you need him."
It was what Flint expected. Buck always said to give him a call if he was needed.
"Everything's pretty quiet right now," Flint told Ralph. "I doubt we'll have to disturb him tonight."
"You fixing to go to bed?"
"Yep, soon as I finish cleaning up a little here."
Since no prisoners currently resided in either of the two cells in the cell room, Ralph would sleep in one of them.
"You can suit yourself about the cell room door. I'll be here in the office for a little while. Then I'll take another look around. I'll lock the office door when I go. If everything stays as peaceful as it is right now, I'll go on to my room at the boarding house, and I'll see you in the morning."
"Right," Ralph replied.
"In the morning. But I'd like to empty my thunder mug before you lock the front door. I've already filled the coffee pot up with water for the sheriff's coffee in the morning."
"Go ahead," Flint said. "Be sure you walk it far enough over in those weeds so a little breeze can't pick up the smell."
"I always do," Ralph replied.
Approximately 100 yards of knee-high grass and weeds stood between the jail and the trees that lined the Natchez River. After dark, the area generally served as an outhouse for the jail and a place to empty waste receptacles during daylight hours. While Ralph took care of that, Flint opened Buck's desk drawer, took out a stack of wanted notices, and started leafing through them on the chance he might see something about a robbery by two men, one of them wounded. Before Flint was halfway through the notices, Ralph returned, said goodnight, and retired to the cell room. Flint found nothing in the papers that would cast suspicion on the two strangers.
Maybe he did shoot his partner accidentally, he thought,
but he was still not convinced. Thinking, more like Buck, he told himself he didn't care as long as they made no trouble in Tinhorn and were soon on their way.
"Besides," he told himself, "that fellow's wound is too fresh for us to have received a notice on it this soon."
At 9 o'clock, the town was shut down for the night. The only place open was the saloon, Jake's place, and it was winding down when Flint took another stroll around town. As he often did, he stopped in the saloon for a little conversation with Jake Rudolph, the owner, and Rudy Place, his bartender. He found Jake standing at the bar, talking to one of the two strangers he had spoken to in Clara's kitchen. Seeing Flint, Roy gave him a cheerful greeting.
"Howdy, deputy. I didn't figure on seeing you again tonight. I was just having a little drink before I go to bed. I'd like to buy you one. What do you favor?"
"Thanks, just the same, mister. I don't believe you ever told me your name."
"Tate," he replied at once. "Roy Tate."
"Flint Moran, Mr. Tate. Thank you for the offer, but I don't normally drink when I'm supposed to be working. How's your partner doing?"
"When I left the room, he was sleeping like a baby," Roy said. "So I snuck out to get a little drink before I turn in. I ate so much in that dining room I needed a little alcohol to burn some of it up. There's some nice folks in that place. We had the sheriff's wife waiting on us, and she took care of us first class. I was afraid we might have worried her when Bart took sick and didn't eat his."
He paused. Then, when he saw distinct expressions of astonishment on the faces of all three of the men at the bar.
"Sheriff Jackson ain't married,"
Jake was the first to remark. Flint remembered then.
"Bonnie waited on you and your partner, right?"
"That's right, Bonnie. She said she was the sheriff's wife."
Roy looked from one face to another, realizing at the same time they did that, he had been duped by the young woman. He struck a guilty grin and said,
"She played me like a fiddle, didn't she? Well, it worked, 'cause I sure didn't say anything disrespectful to her after she told me that."
They all enjoyed a chuckle over that. Then he went on.
"Not that I said anything disrespectful before she said that." He paused to shake his head. I sure painted a cockeyed picture of myself in this town, shot my own partner while I was cleaning my gun, and got played for a fool by the gal in the dining room. Just wait till I see that little Bonnie gal again.
Flint had a pretty good notion about what happened between Bonnie and Roy, and he had to laugh when he pictured it. Leave it to Bonnie to come up with a surefire way to quickly turn off a stranger's advances toward her, if she wasn't interested. As for Roy Tate, he seemed to be a rather good-natured fellow, who could laugh at himself. Flint could see no trouble for Tinhorn from him and his partner. Still, Flint was a little curious about how his partner really got shot.
Where were you and your partner headed before you shot him?
Fort Worth, Roy answered without hesitation. We work for a cattle buyer over there.
I wouldn't have taken you two for cattle buyers, Flint said frankly.
Roy favored him with a knowing smile. When you're carrying a lot of money, it don't pay to look like it.
Flint nodded. I reckon I can't argue with that.
He hung around for a while longer until Roy had a final shot of whiskey and bid them a good night. Flint walked outside with him and stood on the porch to watch him head up the street to the hotel. In a few minutes, Jake walked over onto the porch to join him.
You reckon he's a big cattle buyer like he says? He appears to have a sizable bankroll in his pocket, and he ain't shy about spending it.
Maybe, Flint said. It's hard to judge a man like that. And what he says is true about looking broke when you're carrying a big roll of cash. Him and his partner look more like them that the ones with money have to watch out for.
He said goodnight then and started toward the south end of the street, taking a quick look in the sheriff's office before continuing toward Hannah Green's boarding house. When he reached the house, only one lamp was burning low in the parlor, but he walked around to the back of the house as he usually did. The small room he rented was actually an afterthought to the main house, it being a single room attached to the house by a covered walkway. It served his purposes, for he could come and go quietly at any hour without disturbing anyone in the main house. The town was quiet enough, he decided to eat breakfast at the boarding house in the morning instead of going to Clara's kitchen. Chapter 3.
How the hell could you not know it was gone?
Swan wanted to know.
You got off that horse and back on it 2 times since we left them behind, and you didn't notice that, instead of 3 bags of money, you only had 2? I swear, Eli, you threw your leg over them bags 2 and didn't know one of them was gone?
Well, you was riding right along with me, Eli shot back at him. Did you notice we was missing a bag?
Swan didn't answer. So Eli continued.
How about you, Numbers? You notice we was missing a sack? Junior, you notice one gone?
He didn't wait for them to answer. Instead, he answered for them.
Hell no. None of us noticed the sack was gone, 'cause it didn't have no reason to be gone. None of us thought old Roy would cheat on us and take money that weren't his to take. I oughta knowed better. Him acting so holy and thoughtful and volunteering to stay with poor Bart, I ain't never knowed Roy to wanna take care of nobody before. I wonder how far they got before Bart cashed in his chips. Even if Bart ain't dead, they still cheated us. We counted that money in them 2 bags 2. They packed $15,000 even in both of those bags. That means there was $20,000 in that bag he took, 'cause the whole shipment was $50,000. $20,000. If he ain't killed Bart, that's $10,000 apiece compared to the $7,500 each of us is holding for the same piece of work. I don't know about you boys, but that galls my short hairs. And if Bart is dead, that leaves Roy holding $20,000. So I'm going after him. Am I riding by myself?
Hell no, Swan exclaimed. I took my share of the risk. I want my share of the money.
His response was followed by similar outbursts of anger by Junior and Numbers Kelsey.
I got a question, Junior said. How the hell are we going to find him? We left him and Bart sitting on the side of the river. You reckon he'll try to catch up with us at the hideout?
I ain't counting on Roy showing up there, especially if Bart don't make it, Eli said. Roy's going to want to hold on to old 20,000, so we go back to where we left him and try to cut his trail.
What about the posse? Kelsey asked.
What about him? Eli came back. We lost him at the river.
When it started getting close to supper time, those brave citizens broke it off and headed for the house.
He watched their faces, seeing a hint of caution on their part when it came to returning to the place where Roy and Bart split off. He stated bluntly,
I'll tell you this. I ain't sharing any of that extra money with anybody who don't go with me to find him.
I reckon I'm going with you,
Swan said. Junior and Kelsey volunteered as well.
We'll start back in the morning, Eli said.
They retraced their steps of the night before and found the spot beside the Natchez River where they had left Roy and Bart. Thanks to Kelsey's skill as a tracker, they found their two partners' tracks where they crossed the river, then headed north.
Reckon where he's heading in that direction? Junior asked. He ain't gonna go in that direction, Eli told him. He just wants you to think he's heading north. He'll be cutting back.
In less than a mile, Roy's trail led down into the water, and when Kelsey picked it up on the other side, it led back to the south. They crossed the river once more but continued south.
He's riding around Tyler, Eli commented, and it looks like Bart's still with him.
How you know that? Swan asked.
'Cause there ain't no body laying on the ground nowhere, Eli answered, and there ain't been no sign that he left the trail to hide a body. It looks like Bart weren't hurt as bad as we thought. The two of them must have planned to do this together.
That thought was enough to generate a little more animosity toward the two double-crossers, making them more determined than ever to settle up with them.
That don't make a lot of sense, Swan commented. I mean, them cutting back to the south to go around Tyler? They was already north of Tyler. Why wouldn't they just head west and go around the north side of the town?
It don't make sense unless they're trying to throw us off their trail so we don't know which way they went, Eli replied. I reckon they figured they'd come back to look for him.
So they stayed on a trail that was not that hard for Kelsey to follow, even when it crossed back over the river once again. The trail continued to the north, however, until coming to a wagon road running east and west. The tracks were easily read, turning toward the west on a road they figured must be at least a couple of miles south of the town of Tyler. Less than an hour's ride brought them to a crossroads where a little general store stood.
Let's pull up here and see if they saw Roy and Bart pass by here yesterday, Eli said.
Inside the store, Donald Stokely went to a window to watch the four riders approach. When they rode up to his hitching rail, he walked back behind the counter to wait for them, his hand resting on the double-barrel shotgun on the shelf under the counter. Something about the four strangers triggered a cautious response in Stokely's mind.
Howdy, he greeted them when they filed in. Something I can help you fellas with?
They just looked around the little store for a couple of minutes before Junior spoke.
I was hoping you might have had something to eat.
We don't serve no meals or anything like that, Stokely said. But if you're wanting something to hold you till dinner time, we can fix you up with some coffee and cornbread my wife just pulled out of the oven. Couldn't have been more than 15 minutes ago.
Well, now that sounds to my liking, Eli said. I'll take you up on that. How about it, boys?
He looked around at the others, received three confirmations, and gave Stokely a nod.
Yes, sir, Stokely said. Take a few minutes to make a new pot of coffee.
He signaled his wife, who was standing in the doorway.
C.D., you've got four customers for a cup of coffee and some cornbread.
I heard you. The pot's already on the stove. Don't you fellas know I baked a cake of cornbread this morning?
It was Junior, Kelsey said. He can smell cornbread bacon 5 miles away.
You fellas ain't ever been in the store before, Stokely commented.
You headed for Athens?
He assumed as much since he had seen them ride in on that road.
Athens? Eli repeated, having never heard of it. Have they got a doctor in Athens?
No, there ain't no doctor there. Athens ain't hardly no town at all.
Stokely paused to shake his head and smile.
I declare, you're the second stranger to ask me that question in 2 days. A couple of fellows yesterday asked me if there was a doctor in Athens.
Had he been paying attention, he might have noticed the immediate reaction on the faces of all four strangers.
What did you tell him? Eli asked casually.
I told them the same as I just told you,
Stokely answered. I told him there might be one in Tinhorn, but I didn't know that for a fact. Tinhorn's
a little bigger than Athens. There's a couple of doctors in Tyler, and it's a heck of a lot closer than riding down to Tinhorn, but they headed for Tinhorn.
I never heard of a town named Tinhorn. How far is it?
Eli asked. About 25 miles, Stokely said. Maybe a little less than that.
Down that road?
Eli pointed toward the road. At Stokely's nod, Eli asked,
You say they was looking for a doctor, huh? Was one of them sick?
I think he might have been shot or had some sort of accident, Stokely replied. He never got off his horse, and he looked like he was hurting. They didn't buy nothing. The one done the talking didn't come in the store. He just stood in the doorway, got back on his horse, and they took off for Tinhorn.
Well, boys, Eli said, better enjoy that coffee and cornbread, 'cause there won't be nothing else till supper.
Anxious to get started again, the four outlaws polished off Sadie's cake of cornbread in short order. Much to Stokely's surprise, they offered no objections to his asking price of 50 cents apiece for the coffee and cornbread, and were soon on their way. They left Stokely scratching his head over the two incidents with the strangers, and Sadie pleased with herself for earning $2.
"Looky there,"
Junior announced as he pointed at the sign on Doc Beard's gatepost.
"They got a doctor, all right. You want to stop in there and see if he treated Bart?"
"I'd rather see if Bart's still in town," Eli answered. "And after I find that out, I want to get some supper before that place over yonder closes for the night."
He pointed toward Clara's kitchen.
"Well, we'd best get to looking," Swan said, "'cause it's getting pretty late. And this town's bigger than we thought it was."
"We'll just go to the hotel right next door to that dining room and see if Roy and Bart are checked in,"
Eli told him.
"What if they didn't check in the hotel?" Swan asked.
"You know, Roy," Eli replied. "Think about it. With Roy carrying $10,000, you think he's going to sleep outside under a tree tonight? I ain't toting that much, but I'm going to sleep in the hotel tonight if they've got a room."
That made sense to all of them, so they pointed their horses toward the hotel. Fred Johnson, desk clerk for the Tinhorn Hotel, was just about to turn the desk over to the night clerk, J.C. White, when the four strangers walked in.
"Can I help you, gentlemen?" Fred asked.
"Yep, you sure can," Eli replied. "We're going to need a couple of rooms for the night, and we're also looking for a couple of fellows we was supposed to meet here. They should have got here yesterday. One of them had to get here early so he could see the doctor."
"You must be talking about Mr. Tate and Mr. McCoy," J.C. said. "Why don't you go on to supper, Fred? I'll check these gentlemen in."
Turning back to Eli, he said, "Yes, sir, your friends are still here. Will you be wanting two rooms?"
"Two rooms will do."
Eli turned to give Swan a surprised look after hearing Roy and Bart had given their real names. He thought about it and decided they might as well. Their names were not known in Texas. After calling off the four names, he asked if the hotel had a stable.
"No, sir, we don't," J.C. answered. "We have an arrangement with the stable down at the end of the street, so there's no charge for taking care of your horses. Mr. Lon Blake is the man to see down there, and he'll be open for a while yet tonight."
"What about that eatin' place next door?" Eli asked. "Are we too late to get supper tonight?"
"Clara's kitchen," J.C. announced. "No, sir, Clara will be open for another hour. Just take care of folks like you who check in late."
"Fine and dandy,"
Eli turned to advise the others.
"We've got time to throw our saddlebags in the room and take the horses to the stable, and still get back before the eatin' place closes. Let's get a move on, and maybe we'll run into our friends before they finish supper."
He was in no hurry now that they had definitely found Roy and Bart.
"Ain't they gonna be surprised to see us?"
Grinning back at Eli, Swan said,
"Come on, let's get moving."
He took one of the room keys and hustled out to get his saddlebags and his rifle. He was followed immediately by the others, and soon they were riding down the street to the stable. They found Lon Blake already bringing his horses in from the corral and leading them into their stalls. Spurred on by an eagerness to come face to face with Roy and Bart, they quickly pulled their saddles off the horses and headed back to the dining room.
"Good evening, gentlemen,"
Clara Rakestraw sang out cordially.
We hope you enjoyed this preview.
To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.